Thanks, Tuan. So hello, everybody. My name is Moritz. I am the Director of Engineering in Hyperganic. And I'm quite excited to speak at CDFAM today. It's definitely my favorite event in the year. I'll be talking about democratizing advanced engineering solutions from industrial to medical applications. The title was chosen way before I actually had my presentation, so I might deviate a little bit. I hope you forgive. So I'll be talking about this company that has huge potential but was very difficult to use, as Andreas used to say before. I'll talk about how we are addressing this right now with our, let's say, brand new product offering. So let's dive right into it. So a little bit about myself, probably, even though this is, like Toby said, this is the entire LinkedIn feed here in one room. Same is true for me as well. A little bit about myself. I am half Italian, half German, quite a European mixture. Live in Munich, work for Hyperganic. I have a background in mechanical engineering. I studied pretty much all over the world, mostly in Germany though, and graduated finally in Munich and Bologna in Italy. I have a combine of 8+ years in additive manufacturing. So I started off, I got hooked on additive with multi-material laser powder bed fusion in the Fraunhofer IGCV, where I was able to help people to essentially disassemble, assemble machines, try out new processes. It was very exciting times. I was like, this technology has huge potential. I saw the same thing with Victoria Hand Project, where I was working as a volunteer helper to assemble prosthetic hands for third world countries. A speaker before mentioned that FDM is a very accessible way of producing goods, and that's pretty much what Victoria Hand Project does. Then I joined ArianeGroup, it's the largest space company in Europe, in the, let's say, data connectivity of 3D printers, predictive maintenance, and realized manufacturing is one side, but in order to really do stuff with additive, I need to work on software, and so that's what I did. I joined Hyperganic 3 years ago, and here I am. So let's talk about what Hyperganic does. Hyperganic has a long history and definitely a few bumps, but what we're currently doing, I see some smiling. We do two things mainly. We pioneer next generation physics-driven algorithmic engineering software and scale additive manufacturing applications globally. It's a huge sentence, and I'll break it down slightly, and I'll also focus on only one part of this, which is blue. Here. I'll start with the scaling of additive manufacturing applications. We do have partnerships in the, for example, insoles domain, generally consumer good domain, where we develop bespoke software applications, solutions that we deploy with them, and we essentially automate entire engineering or design processes using these solutions. We have partnerships like, for example, our dear friends at BASF that provide these materials then as well, and other relevant partnerships. We also have Robert Leibe here, should wave. On the other side, we do a physics-driven algorithmic engineering software. We recently launched High Design, which is the first step towards that. We have a huge stack of technology that I'll also present in the next bit of my talk, and what our plans are essentially to productize this technology and make it available to all of you guys, to all the bright minds out there, so that you can design the next generation of products. I kind of already touched base on the content, so here it is again. the future of the application, the next generation applications, lightweighting and compact heat exchangers are some sort of an outlook of what you would be able to do with the product in the future, but what we are already able to do on a coding level, so deep down while using our technology. So what is this technology? We essentially have two parts, roughly speaking. So we have a geometry engine, which is voxel-based, embeddable. I was mentioning these bespoke applications. Essentially, that's the background of all of this. Essentially, we have workflows that we can embed with some sort of a wrapper, and then we deploy it on the metal with our customers. It's quite optimized on assembly level. Yesterday, I had a conversation with the mathematicians about with the mathematician about this. Some love it, some hate it. We make use of it. It's definitely a nice tool to have. And on the other side, we have simulation. All of our simulation methods are meshless, which means they are immersed boundary method simulations. On an abstract level, think of it as typically you would generate a conforming mesh that essentially makes up your simulation geometry and then you start simulating it. In our case, you immerse a geometry into a 3D discretization of space, which has certain advantages because volumetric complexity, so complexity like you see here, is essentially for free. So we do two things, structures and fluids. For engineering, you need both, right? So we have structural analysis, thermal conduction, linear elastic static stress strain, is already directly coupled to the geometry. So we have working products out there in the testing with our dear customers. And on the other side, something that's brand new and I'm extremely excited about, which is going to be part of the second case study I'm showing, is the CFD lattice-Boltzmann kernel, which is again a meshless CFD kernel based on a particle-based method. Think of it as a grid of points that have a velocity distribution attached to it. So therefore, you don't need, again, a mesh. You can immerse your geometry directly into the simulation field or into the quasi-mesh. Something too interesting to point out here is we are working with incompressible phase change low Reynolds number fluids. It's a long sentence. Again, let me break it down. Incompressible low Reynolds number, essentially think liquids. So everything that's a liquid is good to simulate at a certain speed. Phase change has two parts, thermal induced, so if you boil water and evaporates, that's the phase change. So you need to simulate again two things, the multi-phase flow as well as the thermal evaporation. That's something that we're in the process of finalizing right now. Good. With that, let me go to the applications. As the title suggests, we're talking about some applications today. I didn't want to make it too boring for all the architects and designers out there, so let's make it a little more applied. So you see three applications on the left side that are not somewhat grayed out. These are the applications that you could already work on with our, at the moment, for free latticing product, High Design. You can see it at the bottom. You can also do a little bit of lightweighting. There's an example of, for example, a latticed wing back there that is some sort of modulated with a grayscale image. How that can be done, I'll come to that. And then for the later part of the talk, I'll be focusing on the lightweighting and thermal management, specifically leveraging our technology yet on a code level. Okay, so level up with High Design. So High Design is our accessible cloud-native next-generation latticing software. We heard the voices that said, I want to use this technology, it has great potential, but I don't want to become a software engineer to do so. We heard you. That's why we're doing this. And we're committed to making this the best to use latticing product out there. Obviously also generative design once the time is ready. So a few things to point out, only four slides to High Design. We have partnerships with BSF Forward AM. We launched it together. And one thing that's particularly interesting for industrial designers, for example, if you want to work with certain materials, working with lattices is just very difficult. You'd never know, is it going to behave the way it should be? Is it squishy enough, like it was mentioned before? We take care of that. Essentially, we embed the hard work of BSF. Carbon pointed out how hard the validation process is. I guess it's true, you can ask Robert, he knows. We just take all their hard work and make it available to you guys within a few clicks, so you're one step closer to first time ride. I wouldn't say there is a first time ride, but you're at least a lot closer to it. And the lattices that are generated are generally all automatically conforming to your geometry. TPMS, who doesn't love them, also supported. We have a bunch of features that are quite interesting. Various single-click modulations to make it as easy as possible for users to essentially do things like you can see here. blend multiple TPMSs into each other, create new structures, create new TPMSs that might have interesting properties, and apply multiple, very easy to apply modulations. So you can grade it and modulate it, etc. Coming to further features that are included, obviously latticing something is not good enough. You need to do more. So we have grayscale modulations, and I want to point the attention here to the green image. And you can see that the lattice beams are getting thicker from the getting thinner from the center to the outside. That is achieved by loading grayscale images as some sort of a proxy of simulation data, for example. So you could import a grayscale image and use it as, for example, a thermal field. In this case, this could be thermal conduction in a mold, and then the areas where you need to transport away more heat, you could modulate stronger, and so on. Skinning, shelling, embossing, some other geometric corrections, stuff that people need, the basic hygiene, but again, with an emphasis on making it very easy to use. And then lastly, shout out again to 3MF1. We support a quite wide range of these exports. We are still hoping that volumetric 3MF might pick up more, because that would be the most lightweight format for us. Decimated exports and some manufacturing formats like image stacks or CLIs. Yeah, that's it to high design. I just want to mention it's free. I'll mention it again. If you want to try it, 90 days for free. So, looking into the future, what other applications are we working on, and what kind of tricks are we employing to work on these engineering type of applications? So I'll start off with a lightweighting of a drone wing structure. You can see a little bit smaller model, to be fair. Here you can also see it on the table in the back if you want to get a touch and feel. So I personally, since I've worked in aerospace, I really like these space pictures, so I hope you also appreciate them. So the objective here is we wanted to replace the standard spars and ribs configuration with an optimized sandwich structure. You can see a drone that could be a typical drone where you would replace the wing internal structure by something more advanced. What is the approach? We selected a metamaterial. By the way, this is driven by customer needs, so this is somewhat changed, because you can imagine this is a sensitive topic, but the overall approach is the same. The material is aluminum. We're using the Voronoi's because they are quite adaptive, and you can really control the volume fraction over the span of the wing. You have much more control generally than normal beam lattices or unit cells. And we want to stick to the linear elastic range, because typically drones are so small you can neglect a lot of effects, and linear elastic is just fine for this purpose. You can also see the setup. Location of the fuselage is blue, and the lift at the quarter chord line is indicated in orange, so lift upwards, obviously. A few words to the simulation again, just to make it a little more visual. What does immersed boundaries mean, really? You can see the conforming mesh on the top. I grayed out because that's the past. And the future, the bright future, is the immersed boundaries, where we immerse the geometry into this 3D discretization. One thing to point out here, the simulation scales cubically, as you can imagine. So for us, convergence was achieved by 4 simulation elements per beam, which resulted in 30 million simulation elements. So that means there's actually quite a lot of RAM required. However, it can be well parallelized. Since we are talking about an optimization problem, so how do you optimize? We wanted to find the best suited optimizer for our problem, and we quite quickly extrapolated or realized that looking at all the optimizers out there is probably not quite feasible. So what we did is we took a shortcut, essentially, and trained a surrogate model that learns the effects of design inputs and gives us some feedback on the output. So for example, simulation field and volume and other aspects that might be interesting. And so with only 1,200 simulations, which you would anyways do in an optimization, we were able to reasonably well represent what the structure would actually do, and we could very quickly evaluate all these optimizers. By reasonably well, you can see yourself what essentially how well we fitted the data. Obviously, the more data you have, the better you can train your model, so it's a loop. So differential evolution turned out to be the best suited optimizer for us for this parametric scenario, and so we applied that. And then overall, what this looks like is the following. So we start off, the optimizer kind of explores the space a little bit, and you can see that the structure first is very dense and essentially is too heavy, and then it gets a little sparser and then slowly starts converging, and then finally we arrived at the shape like this. One word to parametric optimization, obviously we're limiting the design space, you can all imagine, but this was wanted by our customer, so that's why we did it that way. Still, I think it's quite a nice project. I really did enjoy working on that. Some results. So we replaced essentially 10 to 20 structural components, bars and ribs, according to literature, and by one component, one printed component, and the volume fraction, we were able to almost keep a volume fraction of 50%, a little bit more, 55% in our case, but still it's one component, not multiple. Good. Short talk. I'm already at my last example, the design of complex heat exchangers. You see heat exchangers like this one pretty much all over the web. Everybody is talking about compact heat exchangers. Let's employ TPMSs for heat exchangers. Let's make them more compact. And the next case study is not so much about the design of this particular heat exchangers, because it has some inbuilt flaws, and it's more about simulating it and finding out if we are able to detect these flaws. Which brings me to the lattice-Boltzmann CFD. So again, the objective is, given this heat exchanger design, and it's a counter-cross-flow type of scenario, so you see on the bottom, the blue domain enters and flows across, that's why it's cross-flow, and the red enters from the top, so the hot domain, and exits on the bottom. And so what we want is, we want to evaluate the fluid dynamic performance and the cooling capability of this heat exchanger here. And so first, since we're at CDFAM, computational design workflow, you're still able to use our technology on a coding level, and I personally do actually enjoy that. So I built a coding module, essentially some sort of a class hierarchy to build up this heat exchanger, and that's where you feed in fluid domain parameters, interface definition, so how do you actually attach this heat exchanger to something around it, printability parameters, so what would be an overhang, for example, and the TPMS type. I personally do geek out quite a lot on TPMSs, so you can see research suggests that using Fischer-Koch or Schwarz-Diamond is a good choice for these compact heat exchangers because they have a great heat transfer or heat transfer rate, while still have relatively low friction of the fluid inside the structure. So we applied Fischer-Koch, then you can see some sort of computational design workflow, and out comes a product family. So you have multiple heat exchangers that could come out of this based on the inputs that you provided. So what does the simulation setup look like? It's a relatively small domain. Admittedly, we only roughly 1.5 weeks ago finished the multi-physics simulation of both thermal and fluid in one simulation, so we opted for something more conservative. Height of the domain is 20 millimeters. The effective heat exchange surface area is, even though the domain is very small, is 0.6 0.012 square meters, surface to volume ratio 490 square meters to cubic meters is not super good, but it's also not bad. It's, I would say, it's roughly 60 to 70% on the overall scale of compact heat exchangers. And since Lattice Boltzmann is a 4D simulation, you need to discretize also in 4D. So we have three dimensions in space, one dimension in time, and you see all the input parameters. So we provided pressures and an allowable pressure drop, and then we ran the simulation. And so after 60,000 iterations, we had the results of this simulation. So you see it on the left side, the results for thermal. On the right side, you see the results for the fluid dynamics and some estimated results. So the overall mass flow is 0.5 grams per second. So it's definitely not a high mass flow. Logarithmic mean temperature difference, 27 Kelvin. Actually not bad, considering that 65 Celsius goes in on the hot side and 15 Celsius goes in on the cold side. It's not a bad value. Heat transfer, 53 watts, and overall heat transfer coefficient, 161 watts square meter Kelvin. More on the low side as well, but let's look at why and what could be potentially done now. So like I said, the overall heat transfer value is not the highest. Like I said, it's not about the design itself, it's more about the validation of this design. Because typical water-to-water scenarios would be at 1,000 watts per square meter Kelvin. And you can see that the flow chokes at certain areas. So I'm too far away from the microphone, so I pointed at the locations. So at the outlet is just way too small. So the flow essentially doesn't really flow out. It's not a nice steady flow, not nice uniform flow conditions. So what could be done? First of all, you would want to get rid of the choking points. You would want to have uniform flow conditions. Like I said, you could achieve that by grading. You could achieve that by placing your outlet positions in a better way, and not just having a manifold that collects everything and then channeling everything out through thin pipes, which is something you see all over the internet, to be honest. And we could also explore different types of TPMSs, obviously. Maybe the choice in combination with the grading wasn't the best choice after all. So with that, I'm on my last slide. I want to point out again, use high design is for free. We want to make this the best latticing generative design product out on the market. And by your guys' feedback, it's one step closer. Try it out. If you hate it, let me know. If you love it, also let me know. I always appreciate the feedback. And yeah, thank you for everybody. And yeah, thanks.